Well, it's a great privilege to be in conversation with you at the world premiere of Recasting Cells. I think I really related personally to this film because I teach at Christ University, which has 22,000 students, and more than half of them are from Kerala. And, you know, I teach on an MA in Cultural Studies program, and it has been incredibly difficult to talk about caste. And we have courses on caste. We have a paper in Dalit literature. There's a paper called Gender and Caste. And I found it marvelous in the way your film opens out the question of caste from being an ideological position into being something nuanced and contradictory within people themselves. You know, the ambiguity that you can be a Dalit person, but you can be anti-immigrant. You can be a Dalit man, but you can beat up your wife. These are things that get lost sometimes when we, in our zeal to be good teachers, try and brainwash students into thinking in a certain way or another about issues to do with caste, which is basically the ideology that one believes in, right? Without a personal experience of being a Dalit person or SC, ST or OBC. And I think this is a great film to open out that discussion among students, because what I found is that I think one can call Bengal and Kerala two formerly Marxist states of India now. The students from these two states are the most reluctant to talk about caste. And it is the students from UP, MP, Bihar, Tamil Nadu who are very vocal about caste. And one of the things is that the SC, ST and OBC students conceal their caste. Even when at a MA level, when we have papers in caste and gender or Dalit literature. And I think this then reflects as a great failing of the academic system, because despite teaching students this and teaching it with the intention of having them actually converse about these issues, there is an elephant in the room which is not addressed. And the only thing that emerges is the anti-reservation discourse. So, my first question, and congratulations for kind of, you know, filming this scenario. But my question is, what was your experience of actually filming this whole thing, and some of the questions that might have emerged for you in relation to the complexities of caste, and how the public discourse that is available to us is just not adequate? And what film can do then to contribute to that?
Thank you so much, Rashmi. I think you raised some very, very important and very valid points. And particularly within, also, you know, you talk about the contradictions within the Dalit self and the Dalit identity and issues of silence. And also, you know, the link between, like that's an interesting point about, you know, Bengal and Kerala being, you know, Marxist states. And this issue of silence there. But, you know, let me just take you back to the period of time that we were filming. And I often ask myself that if we were not filming in February 2016, what would the response to caste issues be on campus? Because to my mind, in February 2016, I mean, the CREST Dalit students were forced to confront Dalit identity. They were forced to, in some ways, confront, as that young student says, you know, he says, well, it can happen to me, it can happen to you, it can happen to that person. I mean, there can be Rohit Vemula, what happened to him can happen to any of these kids. So this, we found that the issues of discrimination, you know, caste prejudice, these stories were coming out. I asked myself, if it was another time, would students have talked to us, you know, so easily, right? And then, of course, to my mind, something changes, and this is a question I actually want to, you know, I want to, you know, ask you, but I also want to share with the audience. Isn't the task of an organization like CREST somewhere to train people to have a certain kind of erasure of past caste discrimination, to give them a nurturing environment where, and this was actually, we noticed, a nurturing environment where the students were equal. Even the different caste groups were not perceived. They, you know, so everyone is together. There's a sense of solidarity. 1 week before you're leaving to join the corporate sector, you know, there's a choice of doing a play on caste discrimination in Rohit Vemula. I'm even wondering if psychologically the students rejected the idea of doing that play because of where they were at. What is, of course, interesting is that there's, in terms of the other play, which they accept readily, there's also a kind of externalization of prejudice, if you like. Mm. So what has happened to them in terms of their own experience of growing up as young students is externalized to the body of the Bangladeshi or the Bengali migrant. Yeah? But I tend to agree completely that there are certain silences around the issue of caste. And in fact, I think later on when we move it to the audience, Vinod will open it out because I know he has a very interesting perspective on silence around issues of caste in Kerala.
Okay, so I will. We will open it out soon. We have time till 8:30, right? So, just one more point, maybe, and then we can open it out. So, this thing about erasure and silence. This is again, I draw from my own personal teaching experience when I respond to this, and it's interesting because Dakshin Bajrangi, as I had mentioned to you earlier, is an old friend. I've known him for many years, and in fact, I'd written an article long ago on Chara theatre and how a lot of younger Chara people are getting into media production and television and, even reporting on crime and things. Mm-hmm. So, and where I had kind of put out this question of whether they are deliberately shying away or moving away from a certain kind of media historiography that one sees in the trajectory of third cinema, for example, where you embrace your roots. So, that, but I won't get into that here. But this question about erasure and silence also came up very strongly because it was interesting to see the students watch a Harry Belafonte song, who I think is lovely, but they weren't introduced to Harry Belafonte in the context of him being a black singer, but in the context of somebody to emulate in terms of diction, which I'm sure no English person or American would teach their students to emulate because that's, a far more seductive accent than the English or the American one. But it was the white handshake. So I'm wondering whether mainstreaming, which seems to be a solution, is the only solution. And I also think of this in the context of our colonial history. And we have now suffered 200 years of Macaulay's consequence of Macaulay's ignorance of Indian literature. But do we now say that it is an unfortunate circumstance and do we perpetuate it? Does becoming modern have to be equal to becoming Western, becoming Anglicized? Is there a way to hold on to or find a regional linguistic vernacular modernity? And what is the kind of violence that imposes upon individuals who are, who have to fit into a mainstream society? So I think these are very large and overpowering questions. And hats off to Crest for taking them on. so boldly. So you may want to respond to that and we can then open it out to the audience.
Absolutely. I mean, I think you bring up many very, very crucial points, in terms of a particular kind of culture, in terms of, which has rightly been described as being an absurd culture, but a particular kind of theatrical performance that is necessary or is believed to be necessary in this particular corporate game, right? But whether there are not other forms of vernacular modernity, other forms of gestural language that can be employed. I do want to say something because to respond to your first point, I do want to say that Harry Belafonte coming up, I think that was the way you see it in the film was much more a kind of structural cut I did to link up the contrast between Suresh's family and Suresh talking about, being left behind and this culture being destroyed to progress in this context where, a particular kind of, a different kind of English dialect is being spoken and practiced. I do want to say, though, that Nirmal Joy is very careful in terms of teaching this particular module, that entire history of, you know, of locating black protest and the song of protest, and Harry Belafonte himself, you know, is talked about to the students. It's just that, you know, in terms of the edit, I just left it out. I just think that the CREST model obviously is not the only model, but I think it's in terms of emancipation of Dalits and Adivasis, but I think it's a very crucial model in terms of creating that space in areas where there's no affirmative action. And it is, from my conversations with Vinod and some of his colleagues, it is still such an uphill struggle, you know, because does discrimination end in the workplace? Absolutely not. As Nirmal says in the film, you know, will 5 months make such a difference? Probably not. Some kind of a difference, but, you know, so it is, there are obviously other forms of emancipation for Dalits and different movements. And I think, you know, those have an equally valid place.
Yeah, I mean, I'll come back into the conversation. I think, sir, would you like to add your perspective? Yeah.
First, let me congratulate for the wonderful film you made on CREST. And of course, you know, it got an opportunity for me to see what we are doing. And one thing, you know, in Kerala, it's almost difficult to talk about caste, which actually you observed very well. And there's a feeling that Kerala is a kind of a casteless society, which has been created by the, possibly by the communist movement also. You know, we are a kind of land reforms has happened. And once you are the feudal infrastructure, quote-unquote, feudal infrastructure changes, the caste also vanishes. This idea we all had in Kerala. But when you go to any classroom in Kerala, when you go to any academy institution, there is a ghetto in every classroom in Kerala. You find a group of people sitting backbenchers who are not very fluent in English, who are not a very fancy kind of dressing pattern. You don't have much to talk about your parents. You don't have much social capital. And there's a ghetto is there in every classroom in Kerala. And if you go to higher academic institutions like professional colleges, you find the ghetto and cornered, you know, ghetto. This is the thing happening. Unfortunately, this is not being discussed in Kerala. So whenever we talk this issue in Kerala, somehow students don't want to debate on this thing. And that's why the film, when they move to Rohit issue, no, we don't want to talk on that. Rather, we will want to talk something directly related to economic issues. That's labor, which is, of course, major contributor of working class labor from Dalit communities in Kerala. So there's a concern for them. At the same time, they don't worry about it. This is one point I just... Other thing I was actually... this when I was showing the film, I was just coming. I was looking through the... Usually, I don't go through much about the students' Facebook accounts and all. But recently, I was watching many of our students' Facebook accounts, and I just want to see where they studied and all. So they have put where they studied in the kindergarten, they have studied in high school, college, then professional colleges. But many of them has not mentioned CREST, though they say that they have achieved a lot from CREST, because when you utter the name CREST, you are associated with a particular community. By personal life, I don't know whether any of our former students have come here. Anybody? Yeah, Archana, could you come here? She's a coffee taster. She studied. Could you please come here this side, Archana? Maybe, shall I take liberty
yes,
to
please.
Call? Yeah. Please, Archana. Oh, I didn't see you, actually. I didn't know that you were here in the thing. So this is something which I know for some people, the majority of them don't want to. This is one of her best students, and she, after their master's program, she wanted to become a coffee taster. I didn't know that there was a job called coffee taster. And she applied, and that's a dream, childhood dream. And somehow she made it. Maybe you could put a few words?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
This was actually a journey. It means memories, lot of memories, CREST. And whatever they talk, that was my experience too. From childhood, means from school days itself, I have faced a lot of caste discrimination from my own best friends. So I was very relatable to this this film, and
Thank you. Nice to see you here. Yeah. So that's it. Yeah. Caste is a very serious issue, but of course, very few, but majority of the people are not ready to talk about caste. But there's a difference in Bengal. I think, is it like that? I don't know, actually. I didn't. But Kerala is. We were always talking about Kerala. Like, is there a chance of people talking about a kind of Bahujan Samaj party in Kerala? Impossible, I would say. Though we have 10% of the Dalit population, because there's a different, area to work on. Thank you very much, yeah. And thank you again for the wonderful film. Also for the organizers. And this has got an opportunity for us to be showcased in a very good audience. Thank you very much for organizing.
So
thank you.
We'll open our outlook.
Excellent participation.
So I'm a student of journalism from St. Joseph's College. And a lot of our course is designed around caste journalism course. So we were studying Sainath, P. Sainath recently. And one question that kept coming up was the politics of representation when you talk about caste. Like, when you're representing caste and the stories that come with caste, there is always a sense that you seem patronizing. A lot of writers, a lot of journalism, a lot of film comes with that. Did you face that challenge? Or if so, do you want to talk about the politics of representation when you were filming this movie and when you finally edited it?
Okay, that's a very good question. But you try and film the students in their environment the way they were and the way they perform. Now, in the beginning, I'll just give you one instance. I think it usually works better in terms of an illustration. One of the opening scenes in the film, you have these two young women, one of whom actually then ends up playing a much more important speaking role in the film, Priyadarshini, and the other woman being Shalini. You have them literally freeze on stage. Now, I may have felt uncomfortable putting that scene in, but for the fact that Nirmal makes this wonderful intervention. You know, he just explains it to the audience. And of course, it's true. It's the first time. It was the first day we were filming. And there was the sound recordist with the boom pole right next to these young students. So, you know, they froze. So that becomes a situation where in a different context, you would have to be very careful where, because you don't want to come across as making fun of them. You know, obviously the English is incorrect at times when you listen to some of the other students also talking. So, you know, you have to just take that call in terms of when you're using this material and in what context. But this is, in this context, I have to say that one needs to be careful. I did find, though, that the students were extreme. Okay, maybe there were a few grammatical errors when they spoke English. They were extremely articulate. They were very open, you know, and they really told us a lot of their stories, you know. So that makes this this issue of representation or the portrayal of the students, it makes it, that task much easier. And I think CREST helped us a lot in terms of this, in terms of getting the students to relax, but also really being very open in terms of giving us access. At no point did we ever have a situation where CREST told us, we forbid you to film this scene. You cannot go here, or you cannot do that. You know, so that automatically builds up a sense of trust with the team as well.
There's one question here, and then, yeah. Want to ask you?
Yeah. I have a question for Mr. Vinod as well. The bit I found really striking, the bit that you where you talked about it almost being a kind of absurdist comedy, the whole performance of the handshakes and everything else, and how you recognize the irony of presenting that, but still recognize that it's necessary to do that. What I was wondering is how it was presented to the students as well, as it being a kind of performance you have to learn, and is that how they received it as well?
I think we tell our students this is performance. And I don't say that this is actually a kind of personality development. We don't even use the term. You can change your personality by doing certain handshake or power interview or power dressing. This we always tell. We always, while doing this thing, we do a program called field work. They have to go to their own community, work for 1 week, to collect oral history and understand their own past. So when you understand that thing, they understand the absurdity of that, what we teach in also. At the same time, when you go for a corporate interview or for any interview for that matter, you know, many such things are being required, and they can't do it with that, you know. But that they know the difference. People behave in a different sense when they go to temple. They may differ. They may go to a bar or a pub, and they may change in different style, and they may go for interview. They know how to perform. That's all.
I am Master of Social Work and basically psychiatric social worker. What I observed in your discussion is most of the good things are there, informative and educative and everything. I will appreciate that one. With my rich experience as a SCST officer for the last 35 years, now I have retired somewhat. What I observed is we lack one thing is, even among the caste and creeds of Dalits, there is inner conflict is going on. That is the clash between creamy layer and below creamy layer. Maybe you know it or not.
Mm-hmm.
It is a great issue now.
Right.
Why the most of the people trained in the crest have not ready to expose that they are the students of crest means they deliberately, intentionally, they want to avoid that you belong to so-and-so caste. Even in the metropolitan city like Bangalore, they will come and ask for the rent. They will say some different caste that though they belong to SC or ST. That is the question. In such a transformation period, what effort you can make? Of course, you are giving a very good thing to a very small amount. 0.01% may not come for 1,200 students what you are trying. And one thing is, I don't know whether we have to push up them to the IT sector. Nobody is ready to accept. We have to push up them because forcefully they have to compete rivalry with the merited students. Naturally, it becomes that they are going to underrate themselves. Welcome. Maybe conversation with English or something that is different. But psychologically, they will be depressed just by seeing the environment itself. Nobody is ready to accept them as a common man. The suggestion, what will be your suggestion? What more can we make them?
You know, I'm not really able to offer solutions here. But I think a lot of the points you raise are very significant, you know, important in terms of the creamy layer, non-creamy layer, or even hiding your own identity, as you pointed out, as in you don't say, as Vinod pointed out, you don't say you're from Crest because immediately you're recognized as being from particular communities, you know. One thing I will say is that I was very heartened to hear that, and I observed some of this myself, these interactions are not, unfortunately, there in this film. But we did film a lot of ex-Crestians or ex-Crest students coming back and giving some time to the current students, you know. And Vinod tells me that there's a lot more of this that is happening. So, you know, that reinforces, the reinforcement of these bonds within this community, I think, is very, very important.
I just want to add to that, if I may, very quickly. I mean, you know, this question of hiding your caste identity becomes even more complicated when you're outside of your community with other people because there is also this sense of guilt that what I have achieved is because of the privileges or, you know, positive discrimination or affirmative action that my caste brings. So students sometimes who have scored very well and have got admission on their own merit feel guilty. You know, and so a large part of this hiding of caste also comes from this sense of guilt, which is not their fault at all. We can go to that question.
Yeah, hi. Actually, my question is a continuation of the question. I'm fairly new to this topic. I don't know too much, so it might seem a little naive, but it seemed a little catch-22, you know, this whole idea of why should it be a problem? As you know, you mentioned, when the students don't want to discuss the caste issue, is it really a problem, or is it a cue, you know, a subconscious cue that they might actually be wanting to move on from it, especially given that the context of this course is a non-reservation category? So is it then a baggage that someone else wants them to carry along when they don't want to, while at the same time perhaps there's a need to bring them up to some kind of leveling in terms of personality or communication, but they may not want to carry on that identity, you know, and why should it be a bad thing? That was one. And the second thing is, because this course mentioned confidence building and also communication, And it just seemed, you know, to me the most confident when they were singing their own song, the Adivasi song. So why not, like, do the confidence building more in their, you know, in their own, identity? Why does it need to be in English? And then English can just be semantics, right? It could just be, like, literally, once you're confident about where you're coming from and where you want to go, then it's just a matter of me learning French or Chinese or whatever else I want to learn. So these were two questions.
To respond to the first, I mean, I just like to say that my initial reaction to the students not wanting to, you know, particularly when I looked at the footage, the students not wanting to do the Rohit Vemmela play was one where I was disturbed. And I saw it as, you know, in a sense of an apolitical, non-engaged Dalit politics being practiced, or Dalit self, right? That was my initial reaction. And also, obviously, because this the material on this sort of externalization of prejudice or bigotry to the body of the Bangladeshi, you know, that is disturbing, some of that material. Over time, I have changed my opinion a little bit to arguing precisely that this was almost like a collective choice made by the students at that particular point where they are going out to seek jobs in the corporate sector. They don't want to be pulled back to a moment or pulled back to a world where which they will not be able to express. Or it'll be very unlikely that they will be able to express the entire story of Rohit Vemmela and what happened and the distress they felt at that period of time in this new world or this journey that they're going to. So there was a sort of a recalibration, really, in terms of the way I looked at this issue later. I don't know if you have anything. Let me just add one more thing to this. If you look at the environment, the film team clearly is pushing the Rohit Vemmela incident. You have the Crest faculty, if you just see how, you know, Nirmal was pressing the case, and also the, you know, reaction shots of Vinod, you know, where, you know, what they feel that the Rohit Vemmela incident is much, much more important in terms of coverage. Dakshin Bajrangi very clearly wants this issue discovered, because as you also pointed out, his past is also to give a voice to the marginal communities, including from his own experience, coming from a denotified tribal community, you know. And against this, the students react. And, you know, the majority, of course, say they don't want to have anything to do with this. So I think this is something that will keep coming up in terms of when this film is screened, in terms of a debate, in terms of, you know, how do you proceed? I mean, how would you have, you know, I'm just asking you, would you the next time call Dakshin to do this, but would you maybe call him earlier in the semester? I'm just wondering.
In my student days, you know, in the university, there was no strong left movement in left students movement in Karnataka. There's nothing called SFI was not very strong at all. The only forum which we were working was Dalit Vidyarthi Kota. Actually, which we were working, we were very strong. Though we were not by birth, not Dalit background, but we were very active members of the Dalit Vidyarthi Kota, the radical students. Dalit Students Federation's movement, and even the most far-left students later who came out of the Dalit Students Movement, like Pragadipara Vidyarthi Kuta, actually we were Progressive Students Movement, we were all working with the Dalit Movement, because that gave a big forum for all the free-thinking people to work together. Such thing is not happening. Here, this is something I learned. People can openly say that I belong to a particular community, I belong to Mandiga. I'm not very concerned about whether you care it or not. But surprisingly, Kerala is not happening. I don't know why. So this has to be debated in Kerala. And Kerala is such a very strange society that combatment is very clear. You won't believe that it's so strong in Kerala, because the, you know, how it's combatment is very clear. Even you can identify somebody's caste without asking any question. You can simply ask in the village, what was your breakfast? And you get the caste. You can even say the taste of color. When an upper caste Nair woman say white, and I'm very sure she might be meaning off-white. Because there's even everything you can find, this element of fixing your caste, you know. And then, so this has to be debated in Kerala. We can't go forward without debating this issue. That's it. But of the same time, students say that, because we don't work with the sociology students, we work with students actually who want to work in the sector where we'll be joining later, but it's very difficult to work, and that's a confusion we have, how to address this issue. And it's a big. Sometimes, even when I was circulating this year invitation to some of the students, and one student outrightly commented, I'm in Bangalore, but I don't want to think about caste.
Okay, there are two questions. Yeah, one, two.
Actually, my question is an extension of the question that was previously discussed. When I was watching it, I felt like the surprise of choosing not to be political, in this is something that, was something that I experienced in a postgraduate program as well. But to me, I thought, how much of it has to do with the logic of global capitalism in terms of, because the only thing I kept thinking was, I'm not sure if you don't want to discuss caste, but you know, I think we all learn that discussing this is not going to get you where you want to go. So I was wondering, is this kind of enforced, I mean, wanting to move away, is because we are moving to a highly neoliberal state where everything is being privatized and we don't think of things in the matter of rights anymore. We think of, you get ahead if you work hard, and what work, it's that's the logic, right? We've all. So I was curious as to, is there sensitization in terms of that? Understanding the different economic system that we belong in that privileges certain kinds of thinking? And yeah, I just wanted to know what you thought of it.
I mean, I think that's a very valid point that you just brought up in this. You know, you have to bring in the new globalized economy, the kinds of jobs these students are going to get, and whether, you know, what is the political self? What is the political Dalit self? What is its value in that environment, you know? And let's be clear, I mean, you know, and I think Vinod will probably be the first to say this. I mean, this is not a school that's trying to create the next generation of Dalit Panthers, right? It's not. I mean, this is, so that is not, you know, so somewhere, I mean, I almost asked myself after this initial shock of looking at this footage and looking at the material, why was I so surprised at the kind of response of, you know, 32 out of 35 students or 30 out of 33 students wanting to do the play on labor, because the perception is that it directly affects them, you know. And there's almost, with some of them, a threat perception in terms of, you know, their livelihoods being affected. But, you know, so given the sort of sectors, economic sectors where they're going to, it actually makes perfect sense.
I was just wondering about, about the nomenclature also. I think one has to think about the word discrimination itself and how it sits in history that the students are familiar with. What kind of history are they, you know, aware of that they should think of discrimination as important for them to respond to, you know, in a situation of choice making? You know, why did they not choose Rohit Vimla's scene? Also, you know, I mean, I really would like to know how the words that she used is sensitization. You know, it's a very tricky word, but perhaps, you know, even in terms of asking the very different history that probably Kerala has, how familiar are the students to be aware of it in a way that they can respond more, with all that awareness? And, you know, it's such an irony that, you know, do they not know that when they get into the corporate sector, they'll be working with Bengalis or many others, you know, that you should suddenly respond to, you know, again, and put up a play about that is also something to really, you know, to bring into question larger issues, both of history more than, you know, future. So it's something, it's a little sort of uneasy kind of terrain to be taking them towards also. If they don't understand the history, why it is important to even think of caste, then they won't be seeing any discrimination at all, you know. And I think the word discrimination itself needs to be redefined, perhaps. Mm-hmm. That's the thing. I mean, it's just an observation kind of a question, sort of.
Last, you get the last word.
So I am a Nayar woman, and apparently, like, I enjoy a higher caste privilege. But having been raised in Mumbai, I did not realize any of that. You know, and it was only when I started interacting more with my Malayali relatives staying in Kerala that I started to realize this. And it's absolutely true that there is a lot of caste discrimination in Kerala, because this time when I went to Palakkad, there was this Brahmin temple in which no one else is allowed, not even Nayars or anyone else to stay. You know, but when I was studying in Mumbai, I see one of my classmates who is a higher caste girl, but she has made a certificate which is of a lower caste by paying money so that she can enjoy the privileges. Now, I'm not saying that this should mean that, you know, reservation is bad. It's absolutely necessary because there are certain people who absolutely need that. But just because we are not even having a discussion about caste in cities, this is the kind of situation that is prevailing over there. You know, so is there a way that a discussion would actually help that? Or what can we do about it?
I think it's really important to, you know, completely bring it out in the open. I mean, even in this film, you have some of the students saying that, you know, why am I being made to feel ashamed? Reshma says, why am I being made to feel ashamed? It is my right. And you have to embrace it and you say it is your right. Equally, you have some students here who are using the category of reservation, who are even getting to places like Crest, but then they turn around and they say, oh, I'm a merit student. You know, so there's, you're in a sense, you're being forced not to acknowledge the reality even to yourself because of the face you have to project outside in society. So I think the only way really is to have an open, honest conversation about it, you know, on campus and even outside.
I'm going to take the, my privilege of being the interlocutor to say one small thing, which is that, you know, in this case, it is the upper caste, the Varna, exploiting something that rightfully belongs to the Dalit community. So it's not the Dalit community's fault at all. So if anybody needs to be, you know, spoken to, I think it is the Savarna person who has done this. The second thing, I don't know how, I mean, this, you know, 10% digit that we keep hearing circulated, that 10% of the population belongs to these castes. I don't know, because I have come across data and I don't know how authentic this data is, so you may know that SC, ST and OBC combined is actually closer to 70%. Yeah. So if we are talking of 50% reservation here, they are being deprived of 20% that should rightfully also be theirs. So in other words, upper caste people are getting undue benefit of 20% of additional reservation that they don't deserve. Also asking for. So I think this 10% figure needs to be somewhere. Anyway, thanks a lot.
I always feel like the class monitor who's, you know, tapping. Thank you all. As I said, Lalit is here. People from Crest are here. So you can continue the conversation over some refreshments and snacks. But thank you so much, Lalit, for bringing your film. I suppose this is the task of a filmmaker to always actually ask the, you know, represent the uneasy question. So thank you so much for actually making this film. And thank you, Rashmi, for always being part of Urban Lens in some way or the other. And thank you all.
And thank you for making it possible for me to be here.